now back in New York for some counter programming. Flip on your TV and nearly everyone's talking about ways to stay young.
For younger looking skin, feel good and look even better.
Commercials for skin creams and cosmetics galore. But despite the youthful fantasies on the television screen, we are living much longer. Truth is, there are 76 million of us in what the noted educator Sarah Lawrence Lightfoot calls the third chapter, a time for passion and adventure. For her book on that subject, she spent 2 years on the road, gathering the stories of older Americans who've set out on new lives and careers. She added her insights as a leading sociologist and wrote the third chapter, Passion, Risk, and Adventure, in the 25 years after 50. I first interviewed Sarah Lawrence Lightfoot a generation ago when she was a young professor at Harvard University. Even then, she was talking about life as a continuing course in adult education.
Schooling is what happens inside the walls of a school. Some of it is educational. Education happens everywhere.
Sarah Lawrence Lightfoot has now been on the Harvard faculty for 37 years. In fact, upon her retirement, she will become the first African-American woman in the history of that university to have an endowed professorship named in her honor. Among her 9 books, this is one of my favorites, Balm in Gilead, about her mother, Dr. Margaret Lawrence, the pioneering child psychiatrist. Sarah Lawrence Lightfoot, welcome to the Journal.
It's wonderful to be here.
How time flies.
Yes, that's true.
I can't believe it's been over 21 years since I did last interview you. You were writing then about your mother, who is now how old?
94 years old.
And here you are, writing now about aging. What are you trying to tell me?
Well, what happened was, several years ago, I began to hear at almost every cocktail party, dinner party, professional conference and meeting, someone would lean into me and sort of say, in what I began to call confessional moments, something about what they were truly excited about, passionate about, an adventure that they were on that was new for them. And I would listen, and their voice held both extraordinary passion and excitement, but on the other hand, sort of a shyness, a reticence, as if what they were talking about we shouldn't take too seriously. But on the other hand, it was something that they felt deeply about. And I began to wonder, what were these moments about, you know, that people were talking about new learning in their lives, new adventures that they were taking, new risks, and that their commentary about these moments was so much more excited than talking about their work or even at that moment talking about their family. So I began to wonder, again, what is the text and what is the subtext of these moments that I began to call confessional moments? And so I wanted to really investigate this curiosity of mine.
Were you having any confessional moments of your own?
I probably was, but mostly I was experiencing this as listener, as receiver of these other experiences, but there was always something, and this continued throughout the research for this book, that resonated with me about it, that all of us at this point, to some degree, I think, are on a search for meaningfulness, for purposefulness, and we want to find what this next 25 years, this, in fact, penultimate chapter of our life is going to be about. And we're ready for something new, for a new experience, for a new adventure. And I think all of us, to some degree, experience some burnout. Burnout is not about working too hard or working too diligently or being overcommitted. Burnout is about boredom. And so I think in some ways this is about sort of moving beyond the boredom to compose, to invent, and reinvent the path that we're on.
And yet you say that while they would talk excitedly and with passion about this vision or this confessional moment, there was also a note of fear in their voices.
Right.
They sort of closed down.
I think two things are happening there. One is that we are still a youth-obsessed culture. And so what we all believe who have grown up in this culture is that we should be in retreat at this moment. We should be, you know, kind of pulling back and feeling comfortable and staying still. And so these stories that they were telling me that were about moving out, taking an adventure, seemed to be sort of against the cultural norms that we have been embedded in for most of our lives. I think the other thing that's happening is that it's hard to leave these roles that have given us status, that have given us sort of responsibility, that have maybe even given us influence and power. Those roles have become comfortable. And to go on this journey that takes us away from that feels terrifying at first.
One of the most interesting revelations in here to me is that you, in just a few pages, discuss the way the pendulum has swung back and forth in this country toward aging. I mean, there was a time in the early days when Americans powdered their wigs in order to look older. And then there was a time when aging was considered an incurable disease to be treated in old folks' homes, as we used to call it. Mm-hmm. And now here you are sitting before me describing this aging, this growing old as a time of great excitement and adventure and passion, as you say. What has happened to bring about the change in our perception of the elderly?
Well, we're living longer. That's one big piece, that the arc of our lives have changed enormously. So we're not dying at 50. We are, if we're lucky, living to 80, 85, 90. So that this period that I'm talking about, between 50 and 75, as I said before, is a penultimate period. So that it offers us the opportunity and the challenge of doing something meaningful in it. I also think that there's a way in which my message anticipates what I hope will come. That's when I say, and I really mean it, that this is the most, perhaps, transformative time of our lives, most exciting in terms of new learning, limitless in its opportunities. A lot of people don't experience that because the cultural shifts and the institutional shifts haven't yet happened in order to support that in most of us. Well, what I mean is that most people really do see this time as a time of retrenchment, right? As a time they don't enjoy the beauty, the wisdom, the experience that comes with aging. And we continue to look at younger people as those people who have the energy and the drive and the new ideas, right? Now, I must say that Eric Erickson, my favorite developmental psychologist from way back, said in the early 1950s, talked about the stages of life across time, and talked about this time, the third chapter, as the penultimate of eight stages.
And next to the last.
The next to the last. And he said, even back then, that each one of these stages is characterized by a crisis of whether we're going to move forward, progress, or whether we're going to move back, regress. So it is this tension always at each of our developmental stages between progression and regression. And this third stage is a crisis between what he calls generativity and stagnation. Sounds very dramatic. Generativity having to do with using your energies to serve, to teach, to mentor, to express through art, to innovate, to give something to society, right? To leave a legacy. And stagnation meaning I'm going to stay right here and make my mark, continue to make my mark in an individual pursuit.
Well, there's something of a cultural and political factor there, because it was, in 1935 in the New Deal that the Social Security Act was passed and people were told they have a, quote, right to retire.
And a lot of people experienced stopping work as a kind of death.
My father did.
Yes,
I mean, when he retired at 65, something in him died. I know that's a cliche, but I could see it.
And a lot of people continue to experience that. And one of the things that happens in this book is tracing these 40 people, many of them deciding to retire, but continuing to do work that's meaningful, continuing to figure out a way to be productive, to be purposeful, to be creative, to be innovative.
You acknowledge in here that these 40 people you have interviewed across the country do not represent the majority of people in this country. You just put a face on some of these figures by men, women, by talking to them. And it's also obvious that the book deals with people of an affluent class, people who have the means to make choices and to go this way instead of that way, whereas there are 6, 7, 8 million people in this country over 55 who are living in poverty, and they don't have choices.
Well, we think they don't have choices. One of the things I talk about is perceived abundance. How do we experience our life? Do we see whether we have a great deal of material resources or not, do we see choices in front of us? And so a factory worker who's been laid off from his job in Madison, Wisconsin, tells me that he was laid off, that he and his wife went to the flea market every single Saturday with their stuff, trying to trade it or sell it so that they could put food on their tables and continue to feed their family. And at the flea market one Saturday, he saw these strange and interesting sculptures and pieces of art made by artists who were bringing their art to the flea market. And he said, you know what? That's interesting. I could do that. And I'm good with metal. I'm a welder. I'm good with metal. And he went home and began playing with the metal that he had around his house. And he began sort of saying, what do I like? What do I care about? He loves dinosaurs. He's always loved dinosaurs since he saw Jurassic Park. And he begins to create these animals, these sculptures. He takes them back to the flea market. People become interested. He sells them for almost nothing. It catches on. And by the time he's talking to me, he's telling me that he's gotten his first gig with an art gallery. So his sort of innovation, his resourcefulness, and ultimately his pride in his own creativity comes through. This is a factory worker.
One of the interesting insights in here to me is that you say there's a difference between this new learning we have to do when we enter the third chapter and the old narrow cognitive learning of the classroom. What's the difference?
Well, almost everyone that I talk to in this book, even if they were very successful students in school, had had very successful careers by all of the sort of traditional standards, talked about the fact that the learning that goes on in the third chapter is often contrary, a contradiction to the ways in which they were taught and excelled in school. So school taught us to move quickly with speed, to be singular in our ambitions, to be competitive, to not waste time, to not show failure or weakness. And in the third chapter, they talk about the learning as needing to be creative, needing to be collaborative, that we need to fail in order to discover the best way that we can learn. In other words, as the best diagnostic for learning.
To make a fool out of ourselves, you say in here.
Absolutely.
And to be willing to make a fool.
To be willing to fail and make a fool out of ourselves, at least in the short run. And of course, the ingredient that's so important, which is humor, being able to laugh at ourselves, lighten up, you know, not worry about our facade and our persona, but really just get into the process.
One of these people actually says to you that she's learned that patience is a major gift of life, and that it's so important to do things slowly,
yes,
which she had forgotten over the course of her life.
That's right. This is someone who was actually a filmmaker, and she talked about the fact that it was always rush, 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 and her parents actually had talked about the fact that quickly, 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 you know, always being the best by shooting your hand up first, by making it to the front of the class, all of that.
Right.
And what she realized in this third chapter was how glorious it was to slow down, how glorious it was to be able to be reflective, to be sort of meditative. And my favorite thing about this period is restraint. How wonderful it is, I mean, this is my own revelation, how wonderful it is to know a little bit more about when not to talk, when not to move forward, when it's best to listen and sit back, when it's best to just witness and observe. And that kind of slowness of pace offers us the opportunity to see things newly, to discover things that we hadn't seen before, to see the small, incremental steps rather than expect the large leaps forward.
You say in here that you looked into the eyes of these people and saw your own reflection. Are you facing having to unlearn some things that have made you the success you are?
Well, I think that I'm in one of those rare, and I think you are too, rare professions.
I'm graduating from your
third chapter.
Your mother. I'm moving on to the epilogue stage.
Exactly. But as I say, these boundaries are arbitrary. I think my being a scholar and a writer and a researcher, each one of these books that I write is really a quest a new quest for me. I'm able to engage in new learning. And that's a huge, huge luxury. Without many constraints, I'm able to do that. I think there are those professions, I do, and those careers, and the kind of work, really, there where it sustains your curiosity throughout, where you're able, we're very privileged, to grow in it. But I also think that there are ways in which I behave within the context of my institution. I can feel it at a faculty meeting.
What do you mean?
Well, for one thing, for example, I used to reject the idea that I needed to mentor other people. It seemed to sort of make me feel old to establish myself as mentor and guide. And now I embrace this job of mine. It is important that I let myself be a mentor to my younger colleagues, that I work with and support them, that I guide them, that I tell them stories about my own life and my own career. That's one piece. Another, in terms of the restraint piece, is that if I'm in a senior faculty meeting now, I speak once.
How uncharacteristic.
Well, I've learned timing is important, when I speak is important, all of that. But this way of sort of engaging a conversation that's much more listening, and that also offers sort of a historical perspective, is important. And I'm likely to say what I think, you know, really be very honest, very clear. I'm much less cautious about that. And those two things coming together, a kind of a courage to speak your mind and speak your heart, and to say where your ideas come from, even if they don't come from cognition in a scholarly session, and the idea as well of waiting and waiting and choosing your moment.
Is it true, as I have heard, that you went canvassing, knocking on doors, door by door, last fall in the presidential campaign with a 24-year-old?
Yes.
Tell me about that.
I did. Well, one of the things I talk about in this book that's so important that we need to do in terms of projects for the future in our society is really engage in much more cross-generational encounters, discourse, conversation, and movements.
But that's so hard to do because we are separated into our different realities,
right? I think that's absolutely true. But I think that one example that I found so exciting of working with young people and young people working with old people in a common project was this Obama campaign. So in New Hampshire, three or four times, I went out with a young kid from Dartmouth, and this was a really interesting, I kept on wishing that I was a fly on the wall or an ethnographer watching us navigate our relationship.
How so?
And these encounters, because this was a kid who had, you know, voluminous knowledge about the sort of politics and the names, who was incredibly energetic, who had great ideas, who was completely urgent and impatient and a terrible listener. Right? And also someone who stereotyped all of New Hampshire. He thought that they were all kind of backwoods, rural, country people, Republicans, right? And that they hadn't really thought deeply about these matters. And that all he needed to do was feed them the information, right? And not expect them to change. My approach, of course, was one of beginning by listening to them. Not assuming that I knew who they were just because I knew where they lived, right? Not beginning with a stereotype, but with trying to, but expecting that they had the capacity to think deeply as well, you know? And so the negotiation of our relationship was one of my helping him wait, helping him listen. And for him, for me, it was really sort of experiencing and catching his energy, his drive, his impatience, and his optimism.
Clearly, he had more energy than you.
He had more energy. But his impatience often depleted his energy, right? You know, because he was so impatient to get the message across.
You quote throughout this book someone who was on this show recently, Nikki Giovanni, mm-hmm. the poet. And mm-hmm. she has a poem in which she says, "There are sounds which shatter the staleness of lives, transporting the shadows into the dreams." Most people I know, 24 years old or 74 years old, want to shatter the staleness. What have you learned about how to do that?
Well, one of the things that I experienced here in talking to people was this dynamic of loss and liberation, that most people that I talked to in the third chapter had to begin with childhood stories in order to begin to explain the ways in which they were able to move forward into new learning in the third chapter. Because much of what happens in that early time is often a feeling of not being supported, not being nourished, maybe even being neglected and abused.
When they're young?
When they're young. Mm-hmm. And to return to that place of hurt, to try to understand it, not to blame anyone, but to try to understand it, whether that's a metaphoric return or whether that's literally going back to Ohio and walking up the steps of your father's house and knocking on the door and talking to him honestly about what your experience was as a small child. Whatever it is, it's often getting over those early negative experiences, if you had them. It's very, very, at least I experienced it with these 40 people as a very common theme. And people sometimes discovered those early hurts in the process of the interviewing, that something, some story that they had told many, many, many times before, which was a positive, affirmative, optimistic story, they discover the underbelly of as we talk. And the discovery of that underbelly illuminates their reasons for moving forward now.
So when they identify these wounds and they begin to open them, what happened? What do they tell you happened then about enabling them to go forward?
Well, let me just give you an example. There's a public health doctor, 67 years old, from a middle-class African-American family. And he is someone who's always worked very, very hard, most of the time in West Africa, to work on malaria, eliminate malaria, takes his work very seriously. And he has begun to take voice lessons, which he loves. So I say, why voice lessons? So he begins to tell the story of sitting in his mother's arms at age 6 every Sunday listening to the Metropolitan Opera, right? And he loves this moment because he's sitting in his mother's arms and because there's nothing more glorious or radiant than these resonant voices of these opera singers. And he says to his mother one day at 6, "Mom, that's what I want to be. I want to be an opera singer." And she doesn't respond with any words, but what he remembers in conversation with me is this sort of dismissive look that she gives him. And he says, with tears in his eyes now talking to me, it's as if she thought that opera singers were sissies, right? So he retreats immediately. He never raises that up again. And he becomes a wonderful public health doctor, right? Giving to the world, you know. And at age 65, he begins to take voice lessons and he realizes that this is resonant from this early denial. And he experiences, as he says, a liberation I've never felt, a freedom I've never felt. And the real kicker in this story is that he discovers in conversation with me that this learning to use his diaphragm, learning to make the sound come up through his entire channel, body channel, not only feels liberating in that sense, but also that somehow learning and discovering his voice, his new voice at 67, has helped him to become a better doctor. Mm-hmm.
And in contrast to that, there's a woman in your book named Pamela, a psychologist and an activist, who talks very poignantly about wanting, in this stage of her life, to do the, quote, radical thing, to make a difference. And she's disillusioned, or disappointed at least, to find that the solutions seem out of reach, that it's harder for her to rally people to a collective sense of responsibility than she had thought it would be at this stage, and that neither government nor private institutions are designed to prepare to help her make a difference.
Well, this is someone who is progressive, who's has been an activist all of her life, and who sought to make a difference beyond the sort of domain of psychology or clinical psychology. And what she discovers at 60, and she is worried about death. Many of the people in her family have died early. She sees the finiteness of her life, and she wants to take on something big, right? She wants government and hospitals and the whole medical psychological establishment to respond to the veterans coming back from Iraq and Afghanistan to recognize that they're not crazy, that they've been through a trauma of huge, profound significance, and yet she can't get this message across. She feels as if the institutions, the government, the hospitals, the medical establishment are not recognizing their trauma. And so she feels enormously frustrated.
So is she going to spend the third chapter sullen and resigned?
No, she's keeping on pushing. But our conversations gave her an opportunity to really weep at the fact that she believes, I'm at my most powerful now. I have the most to give. I'm the wisest. My voice is strong. My influence should be great. And I feel it diminished at this point.
Does it strike you that there are not enough people in our society who listen?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. If I could think of, there's sort of two things that came out of this book. One, the most important in new learning is curiosity. And that's often dampened or muted in school when somehow children stop asking what I think is a primal question. So where did he go? So then what happened? So why do you feel that way? I mean, just these are primal questions, you know, and somehow if there is an answer and only one answer to these questions, people stop asking the questions. And I think the other thing that's important is the listening. When I talk about this importance of cross-generational projects and dialogues, it is about young people listening to old people listening to young people, having a real discourse with respect and with empathy.
That 24-year-old you politicked with last fall in New Hampshire, what does he want to do with his life? And what did he learn from you about what he could do?
Well, one of the things that I think he learned from me was that he will have many chances to remake himself, meaning that there will be many chapters and many challenges. I think the other thing that we talked a lot about in our walks from house to house was this sort of failure, that is, what I have learned and what most people our age have learned as we look back on our lives, the value of those moments when we have failed and we need to pick ourselves up and move on. And so that I sort of talked about welcoming those moments. But most of the time, he was talking and he was talking about politics, right?
The people in here don't talk much about death.
No.
Why is that? Was that deliberate on your part?
No, it wasn't. I think Pamela, who you just talked about, is one of the few people in the book that talks about death. They're too busy living.
But surely they have to think in the back of their mind. Well, they can see the grains of sand going down the hourglass.
I think there is an expression of urgency in their work, in their new work and in their new learning, this notion of limited time is very much there. So you see this incredible paradox of the emerging patience of this period and this sense of urgency of time moving on.
So I come back to you. What are you feeling, that sense of urgency? You're only 64. To me, that's just adolescence in the third chapter.
Well, I certainly am feeling the curiosity. I'm feeling the urgency. I'm feeling the patience. I'm feeling the courage to ask questions that may not have been asked before, to say what it is I need to say. It isn't that I think I'm invincible at all, but I have these qualities that have been, I think, deepened during this period of time that I think will hold me and will help me move forward in this third chapter.
People in here talk openly about their own fears. What are you afraid of at this stage?
Sometimes I'm afraid of loneliness, even though I'm surrounded by glorious family and friends and have lots of love. Well, I think there is what I experience when I look at people in their fourth chapters is the possibility of isolation, is the probability, not just the probability, but the certainty that as you grow older, your friends will disappear. They will die. And I look at my mother, who's 94, who has deep curiosity, who's using this stage and chapter of her life to give forward, whose mind is vital and alive, and who's a fabulous listener.
What do you mean she's giving forward?
Giving forward, I talk about in this book, as a way of serving society, and as a way of serving society that's contemporary, that's meaningful. Giving back seems to be asking for sort of an anachronism. It's like looking backwards. This is looking forwards and trying to figure out a way of giving and serving that fits the contemporary cultural context.
So what is she doing? I mean, I know about your mother. We talked about it 20-some-odd years ago. I read your book about her. What is she doing now at 94? I mean,
she's very much in the world and engaged in the world. But in the meantime, at 94, most of her friends have died. And I think that I see that as a profound loneliness, right? And so that's one of the things that I worry about.
You finished this manuscript, had to finish this manuscript, shortly before the great economic collapse.
Yes.
How do you think the new reality would change the answers they gave you to their questions? Because these people largely could afford to make this turn.
Right.
How do you think the great collapse would change their answers?
Well, I don't know that it would change it very much. And I one of the things that I get back that I've been hearing is the fact that the capacity to innovate in the time of reduced resources, in the time when you need to sacrifice, in the time when there is less stuff, the capacity to innovate is very much what these people are talking about. Innovation, creativity, that comes out of an experience that we have now of less. You know, that this notion of we have less, we are forced, therefore, to do more with less, to figure out ways of combining our resources, of collaborating, of, as I say, innovating. I remember times at a time in my life when I was lowest, when, and my mother saying, "Sweetheart, out of this suffering will come creativity." And she was right. And I don't mean to be idealizing this at all, but I think there are ways, I mean, even at a place like Harvard, right, that's lost 30% of its endowment, there is a way in which this reduction in our resources forces us to think more dynamically, more creatively, about how we can do more with less. In fact, how we can shape a new legacy in this time of sacrifice.
You make me think particularly of the baby boomers, about whom you write in here without categorizing them. I mean, because all these people are not baby boomers, but some are. The baby boomers in particular grew up in a period of prosperity, of relative abundance. And they saw themselves as powerful actors who wanted to shape the culture and paradigm of their era. And they brought, as you know, considerable resources and wealth to the challenge. Now, the rug's been pulled out from under them, and I wonder how they are reacting to the new reality.
Well, it's true. I think that that part of what we did as baby boomers in our younger years, we were, you know, bodacious. We were audacious. We were entitled. We felt we were empowered. And we felt that we stopped the Vietnam War, right? We felt that we grew the women's movement. We were engaged in civil rights activities. We made a difference. We were the actors on the horizon. And even, it seems to me, with, as you say, the rug pulled out, we still have this feeling about ourselves. We still believe that we can make a difference. We still believe that we can come up with good ideas that might help to solve what's happening now. And we must learn, however, that we are not the owners of this intellectual capital or this cultural capital. And that's why I say that the sort of energy of bringing people together across generations to solve these problems.
The book is the third chapter, Passion, Risk, and Adventure in the 25 Years After 50. Sarah Lawrence Lightfoot, thank you for being with me on The Journal.
You're welcome. It was a great joy.
That's it for the Journal. To learn more from Sarah Lawrence Lightfoot and to share stories from your own third chapter, go to the Moyers website at pbs.org. You can also track campaign contributions to our politicians from special interest, just who is giving what to whom. Log on to pbs.org, search Moyers, and click on Bill Moyers Journal. I am Bill Moyers, and I'll see you next time.